Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info.
Recent science news headlines have proclaimed that the intriguing mystery of the bright spots on the dwarf planet Ceres has been resolved. According to a paper recently published in the journal Nature, investigators with Dawn's mission have ruled out that the source of the bright spots is ice, and have instead decided they are most likely a large salt deposit. Other recent analysis from scientists at the Max Planck Institute in Germany suggests that the bright spots are caused by a combination of salt and some water ice. In this space news, we ask Thunderbolts Picture of the Day managing editor Steve Smith to explore this and many other questions about the mysterious dwarf planet.
NASA launched the Dawn spacecraft on September 27, 2007, and on September 5, 2012, Dawn fired up its ion thruster engine and headed out towards Ceres after having spent a year in orbit around Vesta. Ceres is larger than Vesta. In fact, Ceres was once considered the largest asteroid in the solar system, but it's either been upgraded or downgraded, depending on how you want to look at it, to a dwarf planet. And it is about 950 kilometers in diameter. It's big enough to be roughly spherical, like Pluto, which is another dwarf planet, and several of the recently discovered objects called TNOs, or trans-Neptunian objects, like Sedna, or Quaoar, or Varuna, for example. Ceres is about as large as Saturn's moon Tethys. Tethys is about 1,070 kilometers in diameter, as well as Dione, and Dione is 1,120 kilometers in diameter. So that's probably why the features on Ceres are similar to both of those moons of Saturn, because of its size and density being similar to them. Dawn analyzed gravitational perturbations on other asteroids, like the asteroid Pallas, which ranks as the third largest asteroid, I believe, in the asteroid belt. And those analyses indicated that its density is about 2 grams per cubic centimeter. So according to astrophysicists, it ought to be covered with a thick ice layer. There might also be a layer of silicate rock beneath the ice because its sister asteroid Vesta is primarily composed of silicates as well. Ceres also compares with Pluto's density at about 1.8 grams per cubic centimeter. But on other space news segments with Walt Thornhill, he explains why the mass of an object might not agree with the amount of matter that's actually present. One of the most interesting features on Ceres is the crater Ocketer, and they named it Ocketer because it means the harrower, since Ceres was a Roman goddess of farming and agriculture. Ocketer is a large crater about 90 kilometers wide and 4 kilometers deep. There's a large, bright, rounded rim with a shallow depression and surrounding bright patches inside the crater, 10 kilometers across and more than 500 meters deep. The bright spots were initially thought to be ice.
In a previous space news, we explored the possibility that the bright spots on Ceres were electrical in nature. However, from the beginning of the mystery, Steve Smith favored the notion that the bright spots would be composed of silicates called a, quote, high albedo powder. What is the likelihood of intense electrical activity on Ceres today?
When the feature was announced, though, I argued against the ice idea from the very beginning, and I also argued against water in general being on Ceres. Planetary scientists seem hell-bent on finding water somewhere, but I stated from the start that it would be a high albedo powder, since some of the first data from Ceres transmitted by Dawn showed that it was composed of silicates, carbonates, and sulfates, so any calcium, potassium, or magnesium compounds would be bright white. When the Spirit rover's rear wheel got stuck on Mars and it dragged through the dark surface layers, it churned up a layer of bright white magnesium sulfate. So my thinking was along the same lines, that beneath a dark surface layer, indeed, which Ceres possesses, would be a bright white mineral compounds. But before getting into that more deeply, a little review of Ceres perhaps would be good. The vast majority, if not all, craters on its surface look like they're aligned with its center of gravity. They have flat floors, scalloped edges, vertical sidewalls, craters on the rims of other craters, hexagonal formations, crater chains, pretty much everything that I've written about in past pictures of the day about the Moon, Mars, Venus, Mercury, any other rocky planetary body or moon in the solar system. But one of the funny things about Ceres is the alignment to the center is pretty much an absurd configuration. It implies that all the objects that struck Ceres impacted the dwarf planet at 90 degrees to its surface, which doesn't make any sense at all. Now, there are more than 130 bright areas on Ceres, similar to that bright region in Ocater Crater, and most of them are associated with the impact craters on Ceres. And these areas of salts, like magnesium sulfate, most likely, they were created when water ice sublimated in the past. They say that it was impacts from meteors that stirred up ice and salt. And there's a quote from investigators at the Dawn mission headquarters, and they say, "The global nature of Ceres bright spots suggests that this world has a subsurface layer that contains briny water ice." Now, with the penchant for NASA researchers to see water and ice everywhere that they go, we should probably reserve judgment about that announcement for now. And in fact, not all of the NASA investigators think that there is water ice on Ceres. One of the other major anomalies on Ceres is the bright mound called the Lonely Mountain. And this is described by NASA scientists as, quote, "sharply defined with almost no accumulated debris at the base of the brightly streaked slope and mysterious." Now, a feature that can be found on various rocky bodies is a fulgamite, a rounded circular formation that appears to be melted and raised above the surrounding terrain. And probably the most famous fulgamite in the solar system would be the Olympus Mons structure on Mars, which is a gigantic mound most often referred to as a volcano. The bright raised mound with the shallow depression in Ocater Crater is similar to what you see in Olympus Mons. They're both isolated structures, particularly the central formation, which is brighter than the surrounding regolith. So you have to ask yourself, are any of the electrical effects associated with electric universe theory evident on Ceres? And I would say, yes, they are. There are definite signs of electric activity. But are they happening today? I would have to say no. And now this is my viewpoint. It doesn't necessarily agree or disagree with anybody else. But I would say that for Birkeland current filaments, sometimes associated with what I call an electric auger phenomenon on Mars, Venus, Earth, or most other rocky bodies to take place, there has to be something, there has to be some force or some influence to align the electric charge flow. Birkeland currents, you have to remember, are also known as field-aligned currents. But there's no magnetosphere on Ceres. There's also no electromagnetic field of any kind, so there's nothing to align the solar wind current. Bear in mind also that the solar wind is probably something like 3 atoms per cubic centimeter at the distance to Ceres. I would say that charge density is so low on Ceres that there's nothing there to electrically erode the surface. However, when you look at the mounds on Ceres, the crater anomalies, all this bright material, the cracks and rills that are winding their way through its topography, and all those tall peaks in the centers of the craters, that only leaves one conclusion. Ceres is an electrically disfigured world. So is this a paradox? You see electric activity on Ceres, but nothing that can electrically erode it is present. That isn't a paradox, since it's a principal tenet of electric universe theory that the solar system was involved in catastrophic events some 10,000 years ago or so. So you have to think that Ceres, as I like to call it, is a freeze-dried mausoleum, and I've written that elsewhere. Many pictures of the day argue that the craters in the solar system are the result of gigantic electric discharges from a source that's pretty much in the recent past, but that's no longer active. And it was probably another celestial body or bodies that catastrophically interacted with each other. That event or events left planets and moons burned, blasted, and scarred. And so as of now, they're going to start taking observations from a much lower orbit, and they'll get a resolution of 35 meters per pixel. They'll also get infrared, gamma ray, and neutron spectrograms, as well as high-resolution gravity measurements. So let's hope we can get some better data and resolve a few questions.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.